So there was a video posted by YouTuber My Little Thought Tree. I have provided a link in the description below. It was analysis of a song by an artist named Aurora, and the song was called Runaway. The analyst is a psychologist who has done some incredible analyses of several films and how they use psychological concepts in their screenplays. If you haven't watched his analysis of the film Good Will Hunting, I highly encourage you to check it out. It's revelatory. When I watched his analysis of Runaway, though, I felt there were a lot of things that he missed. I don't want to critique him too badly because I think his analysis is insightful. However, what I saw was that he was analyzing it in a very linear way, from beginning to end, like a story, and not, as maybe he should have, from a musical or a mythological or a poetic standpoint. And so with that in mind, I decided to create my own video because I think in missing those elements, there's a lot that one misses that makes the song special. And so I'm not going to pretend that my video is in any way as well edited as his is. he is obviously much better skills at editing videos than I do. I also want to say that I admire his chutzpah in tackling a song like this, because there is a lot going on here, and I wouldn't have thought to do it myself if it weren't for him. So I do want to grant him kudos for that. But with that in mind, I hope that you'll enjoy my own interpretation of the song and hopefully come away with something from both of our analyses. Thank you. So let's just first take a look at how the music sets the mood for the song. It starts with this chorus of voices chanting, and then they're accompanied by a pair of percussion instruments. The song has a 6/8 signature that's placing the emphasis in the first and fourth note in each measure, giving it a heavy, almost plodding sound. And now the percussion comes in on every other measure, emphasizing again the first and fourth notes, again giving it that kind of plodding funk, funk, funk kind of noise. So, adding to this plodding sound are the eighth rests at the end of each of the first two verses. On these rests, not only do the lyrics pause, but the accompanying chanting and percussion pause as well. Take a listen.
I was listening to the ocean.
Rest.
I saw a face in the sand.
Rest. And now the meter of the third verse is different from the first two. While the first two verses are approximately a measure and a half in length, this third verse stretches over four measures before coming to a full rest. And then the fourth through sixth verses repeat that same meter of the first three verses. So here, take a listen. Full rest. Then you can hear it starting to repeat that plodding sound from the previous verses.
I saw a piece of heaven waiting patient for me.
Now the next three verses have a kind of iambic meter. It starts with an unstressed syllable followed by a stressed syllable. And this gives the lyrics a kind of running tempo. There's a new higher pitched chorus that joins in, accompanying the deeper bass chorus that's in the background, creating a crescendo. And then a snare joins in right at the end, building the crescendo until suddenly the background music just ceases altogether, leaving only Aurora singing a cappella, drawing attention and clarity to the message that's conveyed in those lyrics. And then it goes back to that plodding tempo from earlier. So just listen to here. Ta 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 ta. You can hear that chorus in the background, that kind of high pitched voice, and then the crescendo. Now there you go. There's that silence, just her singing.
I can't take it anymore.
And then we go back to that plodding sound right there. So you can kind of see how just the music here is conveying a meaning of its own. Just kind of it's using just the voice and those percussion instruments, which are just some of the oldest instruments that humankind has ever used. And so she's drawing attention to that, kind of giving us this sort of old feeling to the music, this kind of slow sound to this darkness kind of in there with the kind of that plodding. Makes you feel kind of heavy and almost maybe depressed in a way. And so I love how she just does that with just that music right there. All right, now let's fast forward a bit here and take a look at the chorus, because it's interesting what she does here. This is the first part of the song that has any instrumental accompaniment besides the occasional percussion. You can hear the snare crescendo again, along with the chime-like effect that accompanies the lyrics. The music feels lighter and vibrant, giving the listener a sense of joy and release from the plodding sound of the first several verses.
I was dancing in the rain, I felt alive, and I can't
complain. There's the crescendo, and then we get this uplifting sound, that chime-like music there in the background. Also hear this kind of chorus in the background, almost like almost angelic voices. Now the music fades here, and again we're left with just Aurora's voice. The silence here is the instrument, bringing us down from that high in the chorus. Her long rests between the verses, but it's not plodding like previously. She's giving the listener a chance to pause here to catch their breath.
And I kept running for a soft place to fall, and I kept running for a soft place
to fall. And here we go again. We get kind of this building, this crescendo. There's the snare again, back into that revelry of chorus. And so she's doing a lot there just to convey this emotion of euphoria, and then followed by kind of just resting, this kind of pause, this sort of almost relapse back into that, into that depression of kind of the first part of it. But again, it's different here. It's more like loss and grief as opposed to just plodding depression, like that funk that you kind of had in that first part. And so I love how she does that. And then again, it's remembering that feeling of being at home. Then it brings us back into that that lovely revelry of the main chorus. And so it's just neat to see how she's using the music there to convey meaning. And so now that we've kind of analyzed the music, let's go ahead and cut away and take a look at the lyrics a little bit, because I think that's also conveying something very powerful with the song. So here we have the first two verses, and you can see that the sentences are short. Many of them are fragmented in thought and grammar. There are themes about nature, the ocean, and the tree, goal seeking, picking up the face and climbing the tree. There's this disillusionment, the face in the sand falling apart, and being able to see heaven but not being able to reach it. And there's also this theme of disappointment, with each verse ending with the word down, suggesting falling, either physically or emotionally. And then we have this third verse, which again we've mentioned has a different rhythm and quality to it than the previous two verses. She's running away now, perhaps in an attempt to escape the disappointment of the previous two experiences. She mentions dancing and feeling alive in the rain, implying that the act of running feels invigorating and even joyful. And then in this fourth verse, the background music stops and she states that she wants to return home. And this refrain occurs again in both choruses, where the music is lively and vibrant. So we know that there's something special and meaningful here about home. She even says here that home is where she belongs. And then the themes of the first and second verses are continued in the fifth verse. She's attempting to achieve something with the painting, to bring someone special to her into the scene. She experiences a similar disillusionment as she did with the face in the sand and seeing heaven, and again the word down at the end of the verse, suggesting a physical or emotional fall. This verse has the same cadence, both lyrically and musically, as the first and second verse, suggesting that after having run from the first two experiences, she is attempting something similar to what she was trying to achieve in the first two verses, and it is resulting in a similar disappointment.
And then we have this sixth verse right here. And it starts on the same note as the other three verses. The first line is again a measure and a half in length and ends with that eighth rest. However, this time we have an ascending scale. The difference in the music calls the listener's attention to the lyric, emphasizing the fact that this is something's different this time. The lyrics suggest that she's having a revelation here. She's realizing that her previous actions were attempts to hide and ignore her sorrow. So she's gaining clarity about her life and realizing that what she's been doing isn't working, and that it's been an attempt to deflect and ignore her problems rather than address them. And then the third verse repeats, and this time she's running with the revelation that what she's been doing is not working and that home is where she belongs. And that's when we reach the first chorus. She's realized where she's running this time, that she needs to return home. And then the music slows, and we get this repeated refrain of searching for some place soft to fall. The music has slowed down as if she's out of breath and searching for some place where she can lay down and rest for a moment before the final refrain of the song, where she's running again with the revelation of wanting to return home. However, Aurora doesn't return home. The song ends with her repeating the phrase from the fourth verse. The music video even ends with her laying on a bed of moss, asleep, or possibly even dead in the middle of a forest. I want to share an old Hasidic folktale of a man named Isaac who hears the voice of God three times in a dream. And each time God tells him to travel to the city of Prague, where he will find a treasure under a tree outside of the city. And when he arrives and starts to dig, he encounters a soldier who tells him that he too had a dream, that he should travel to the house of a man named Isaac, where he would find a treasure under the floorboards. He then tells Isaac to leave, and Isaac does as he was told, returning home, and under the floorboards he finds the treasure that he sought. And I tell this story because when I hear Runaway, it makes me think of the hero's journey. Because she starts in this ordinary world, the status quo, where she's grasping for truth but coming up empty. And then she hears the call to return home. And the revelation that she has been hiding her sorrows helps her see that she needs to accept the call and run across the threshold between the ordinary and the special, or underworld. Her road of trials is her journey to find home as she's running through the wilderness. Along the way, she loses her way or stamina, seeking a place. Having caught her breath, she continues on her journey. But what's unique is that Aurora doesn't return to the ordinary world. Like Moses from the Bible, she remains in the wilderness, never reaching the promised land. And ultimately, I think that's what Aurora is trying to convey in Runaway. It's that we are all on a journey to find our own home, our own treasure, our own truth. For most of us, we will never reach that truth, and that's okay. Ultimately, the journey of the spirit and the crossing of the threshold is what matters. And I think that's what Aurora is trying to convey to us through the song, Runaway.